hello. So thank you so much for the absolutely amazing introduction. I'm actually your facilitator for measuring community health, and this is really honestly your conversation. But before we do get into it, I just kind of want to have a quick discussion about widening the discussion about metrics, because for most community managers, regardless of what your specific role is, whether you're an architect or an evangelist, something along those lines, metrics is a very complicated question to answer. A lot of people just get pushed by the stakeholders above them to say, hey, what exactly is the ROI of your community? How can you prove that us funding this project or this open source endeavor, or maybe this brand is actually worthwhile? And on the other hand, it's also your job to advocate for community members. And the easiest way to do that is to show what's happening in your community. What does that health look like? So the question that a lot of people tend to go is, what is that key metric? What is that KPI? And that's a very, very difficult question to answer, not because you don't have a funnel or your marketing setups aren't correct or you don't have the right technological platform, but because what you're really doing is not measuring the behaviors of people in a community. You're measuring the community itself, and people are hard to study. They're hard to research. So this discussion is going to be centered around widening our understanding of what it means to measure a community from just a simple number or a KPI or a funnel to more of a journey, understanding what it means for people to enter your community, what it means for them to engage and kind of move beyond very, very basic metrics. But with that having been said, there's also going to be a diversity of people who are at different places in what I tend to call your metric story. So on one end, it's you're in a cave, you don't have any metrics. And you flip that light switch on and you say, what's going on? And the numbers start trickling in. And then you just see the big wide world and you're like, oh no, there are so many different metrics, and you can get a little bit metrics obsessed. That metrics obsession puts you in this massive sea of numbers that doesn't necessarily mean anything to the ROI of your key stakeholders. And it definitely doesn't sound any bells or anything like that for problems that your community members want to bring up to you. So the question is, what is the story that your metrics, your numbers can tell that both empowers your community members to act and behave, get connected, self-disclose their feelings, their opinion, and their opinions, while also on the other end, ensuring that your metrics prove the ROI and achieve the goals and the mission of your community. So this is a very big conversation. I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to everyone else. But before I do, there is going to be a Google Doc that I am actually going to share here in the chat for all of the people who've come through. And we're going to turn it over to you. So we're going to start with the very specifics. What problems are you having in your community? What's the main trend? What's happening there? And then what does that mean for measuring community ROI? With that said, we do have a few questions that we can get started with in order to move the conversation forward. And feel free to unmute your mics or turn on your video or just post in chat, whatever you feel comfortable with. And then let's just kind of move the discussion in the way that's going to be best for you and your metrics. So the first one that I have is, how do you prove the ROI of your community to key stakeholders? I think this is one of the biggest questions community managers constantly get. And there's a converse question here. What do you expect of those same stakeholders for their participation in community in order to see the value for themselves? So does anyone want to kind of comment on that? What do you do in your communities? What do you think are the biggest trends? It looks like Ray has unmuted.
Hi, can you hear me?
I can now, yeah.
Okay, great. So the question I think needs to be turned on its head, actually. And the question one for O is, for me, O is what does your stakeholder value? Not what your community members value, which is important, but for the community to get funded, to continue to have a meaning in a business context, what do your stakeholders want to do? What do your stakeholders want to get out of the community? What's important to them? What's keeping them up at night? Then you decide, then you align your community along those lines, whether it's along marketing lines, whether it's on support lines, especially on developer type communities, support communities. It's all about ROIs all around, call deflection, etc. But you've got to start with what's of value to your stakeholder. And I think many community managers get tangled up, as you say, Samantha, with all the metrics, the internal metrics, which I would, to distinguish from impact metrics, I would call them analytics. You get caught up with the analytics of the platform, whether it's Cross, whether it's Swoop and Yammer, whatever it is. But I think everyone needs to start with a basic question: is what does my manager want to know? What does my director want to know? What does my funder want to know? What does my sponsor want to know? And then work from there. Then that will give you a clue as to what you should be measuring. Over or end. I don't know whether other people want to comment on that.
This is Israel. Thank you for that particular comment and drawing back to starting with what's valuable to the stakeholder. One of the things that I know I'm challenged by with my team in my environment is the stakeholders are not there. we're building stuff, we're producing stuff for a stakeholder that needs value. But for whatever reason, we're separated. We're several steps removed from being able to talk to the stakeholder. And so I hear from my team all the time, how do we know that we're actually doing something useful to somebody? Or how do we know what our impact is? And so I think it's very important to make sure that there are communication links, open communication links between our group and the people who are asking for our help. Moreover, going back to the question about value, I think a lot of times stakeholders are coming to us asking us to get involved and design and develop a solution, partly because they don't know what exactly they want. And the big challenge there is to not make assumptions, not think that we know more, not to second guess what their ask is about, but rather to get them involved in the actual development stage, design stage, and then to constantly bring them in for demos and reviews so that they feel like they're a part of the process.
First question, can people hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm involved in a fair amount of, I'll call it philanthropic endeavors. And I think rather than, you say you're measuring people, and what we do is we measure impact. It's not all about people. It's about how we affect the community. So one of them is called the Sports Philanthropy Network. It's based in Chicago. It's promoting inclusion. It's trying to help with racial bias in professional and amateur sports, as well as around the country. Actually, the World Conference is next week, what I'll be doing a week from today. And in interacting with the people involved with that, it's a matter of what programs are being provided, what impact they're having on the number of people and what people are getting from it. And then the measurable is how many people get involved after a program. And so I'm a bit curious if the people here are talking about, where are all things open? Are things being affected by technology, or are things being affected by the amount of people that are working on something?
Yeah, I think that's a really, really good point. The idea that your key stakeholders that are funding the community, that are reporting to the community, they're definitely looking for those goals and those benchmarks, those guidelines. So maybe measuring impact and figuring out exactly what KPIs that determines might be more important for them, but they still need to be involved in deciding what that impact looks like and how it should be measured.
One of the things I've seen in kind of past lives in terms of stakeholders is that I think executives like can often perhaps overly focus on what, you know, what metric is going to look good in the press release, for example. You know, we've had 50,000 downloads. So, this month we have 70,000 downloads, you know, whereas particularly sort of softer metrics, they're kind of less interested in that, because often executives are very numbers and data oriented. So they want things that are very quantitative measurements, which may not be, in many cases, aren't really the most important things.
Yeah, and trying to figure out, we tend to call those vanity metrics. And the important question I think occurs there is, how do you determine and when do you decide that those metrics that make you look good versus those metrics that are actually actionable for determining your community health, how do you actually set that line in the sand and figure out what your vanity metrics are?
All right, this is very weird not being able to see the other people. And you're center stage, so keep smiling. So Ray, although I can't see his last name, talks about impact. I am curious, so Ray mentioned he's with the World Bank. I do stuff with the Sports Philanthropy Network. I'm very involved with something called the Jewish Federations of North America, which is, I'll call it, a social services organization. And then several other philanthropies, the largest of which is called the Joint Distribution Committee. And they're located in everywhere you've never wanted to travel, but where there is need for help. And I'm one of those idiotic people that when there's a major storm or horrible something happens, I travel and I set up a tent to help people in all the places, again, you've never wanted to be. And it's easy when you're on site to measure impact. I'm curious if the other people here, especially with the gentleman who said he's with the World Bank, do you get to see your impact, or are you only looking at data analytics? Are you only looking at what comes through, you know, via the data side versus what you can actually see?
Hi, Eugene. This is Ray Eisenberg. So I consult to the World Bank, but I don't travel to far off places as you do, and what we call FCV, fragile conflict and violence areas.
Oh my.
So, and in fact, the World Bank has had to pull back from certain areas like Yemen because it's too dangerous and we can't actually witness ourselves what's going on. But we do that. We measure impact through proxies on the ground, obviously NGOs, local health ministers, education ministers, agriculture ministers, development ministers, who, whatever program the World Bank is involved in, then we measure impacts there. I think the hard thing as a community manager is what, how much can you attribute to what a community is doing versus what all the other programs there are doing. So if you're talking about improving literacy programs, then there are probably half a dozen groups and organizations on the ground there, all working on building schools, training teachers, providing local school access, providing funding for kids to get to school. So what impact does community have in those areas? What does your online or in-person community or online community, and I'm talking about communities of practice here, what proportion of that change in behavior, or whether it's increase in literacy or increase in teaching ability, what can you attribute to your community program? I hope that helps. As I say, we don't have to go there. We rely on reports from people at the scene or on the ground there. Mm-hmm.
I think it's a great question. How do you determine the actions of your community in a sea of all the other actions happening in your community, in your company, or what your stakeholders are doing? Does anyone have any insights, or what are you doing in your community in order to separate those?
Come on, folks, there's 41 of you, someone speak up.
Hey there, I can speak a little bit. I work at GitLab. We're an open core business. One of the things that we measure is our community activity through merge requests that are merged into our product. And so, we know when a merge request is coming from a community member, it receives a label on our platform that indicates community contribution. And then each month, as part of our monthly release, we can count the number of merge requests that are coming from the community. I'm happy to report that trend has been, going up and to the right for a long time. And we also each month pick out a contribution from the community for recognition in our release post. We call that person our MVP, and they receive, not just the recognition in the blog post, but also I think they get some swag or something like that. We're measuring the impact through the number of contributions, which, some may say is a vanity metric, but, I think, to us it's important. But then we also dig into the quality of those contributions and highlight those exceptional ones for additional kind of recognition.
I absolutely love that solution. The idea of having a piece of content that both recognizes your community members and also tracks I totally just lost my train of thought, tracks their activity over time.
Yeah, I think another thing that we do a bit ad hoc right now, but might be cool to formalize into our data collection, is looking at the number of, just to give some additional context, for each kind of merge request or change that someone's proposing to GitLab, there's a corresponding issue in our kind of issue tracker, and community members or other folks can give a thumbs up to an issue that they, presumably want to see resolved. There might be folks that do thumbs ups for other reasons, but I would say the vast majority of people doing thumbs up are doing that because it's an issue that they hope to see resolved. So it could be cool to track not just the number of merge requests, but also count the number of thumbs ups on the issues that we're closing with those merge requests each month to kind of see, if those are high priority or kind of low priority issues that are being closed by these community member merge requests.
Absolutely. That's really cool. I do also want to point out, we have an additional question. Christy, if you want to kind of elaborate a little bit on your situation, we can, but it kind of boils down to, it's hard to incentivize the community to share impact stories in the way that you're kind of mentioning. Do you have any thoughts on advice and development given how large and international the organization that she's participating in it is? Christy, if you want to elaborate, you're welcome to.
Yeah, I'll elaborate a little bit. Hi, everyone. So I work for an international democracy organization, and I work on connecting some of our democracy organizations around the world with tech partners in Silicon Valley to raise concerns about issues that they're seeing in their political context related to democracy online. So as you can imagine, it's a really interesting space to work in. But it's just, I'm still sort of struggling with a way to incentivize. I mean, I guess I'll have to go to this session later about incentivizing and rewards. But incentivizing our members to share some of their impact stories with us, just because they are so busy, they're so overwhelmed. And so it's kind of difficult. So any thoughts on that would be appreciated.
Christy, the first thing I'm going to say, I just took a very quick look at your organization as you started talking. The first thing is, you mentioned that you're trying to partner with companies in Silicon Valley. I would highly recommend to you that you take a look at other hubs around the country of companies that are doing good things. So, certainly I'm sitting in Raleigh, North Carolina. There are no less than hundreds of startup companies in this area that have specifically given time to their employees to do things that support good efforts towards volunteerism. A lot of them are giving time off, for instance, to volunteer at the polls this year. So I noticed, the name of your organization, that seems to fit. So instead of just looking at Silicon Valley, you might, take a heavy look at Raleigh, North Carolina, Nashville, Tennessee, certainly Boston, Massachusetts. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of companies that would be interested in partnering. And quite honestly, I've never even heard of you, and knowing how active I am in the space and on social media, I think you need a social media team to get out there and start putting out your information.
Hi, Christy, this is Ray, Ray Eisenberg. As I said, I'm with the World Bank. We have a similar issue with our community managers, and two approaches that we've taken. One, for most projects, any project team has to report on its proposal, because they're often spending $25 million, $50 million, $100 million on these things. So the bank and its funders need to know, has the proposal been successful? So they're already writing some kind of report. So if you can grab those, then they won't have to do double work in reporting to you. The second thing, and it sounds a little hokey, but we do have a Community Managers Appreciation Day. I mean, we celebrate it like the rest of the community managers community do. And there's a competition around success stories. And it surprised me, but people are really interested in presenting their work and competing. And that has been successful as well in getting success stories. And they, as well as the community, presenting to the other community managers, their own senior managers and directors show up, and they're quite proud when their community team wins an award, some kind of award, for their submission. So those are two possibilities you might want to consider.
Thank you both, that's really helpful.
Absolutely. And I really like one of the other comments that we have in chat about reaching out to already existing communities and just saying, hey, we're a resource. We're here if you're interested, and we'd love to get involved more personally. It was an absolutely great conversation, kind of discussing how we get people involved, move beyond our organization and connect. But I also kind of wanted to kind of move into the trees a little bit and talk about brass tacks, like specific metrics, and maybe members of the chaos community can kind of chime in here. How are you measuring incoming members and whether or not you need to reach out?
So hey, Gail Kia. In the Grimoire Lab project that we have in Chaos, the software that you can use to understand the metrics about community, there is a feature where you can see what community members contributed for the first time, for example, in the Git log. And so if you want to identify new people that have never contributed before, you get that list when they first contributed and you can actually reach out to them. And it also goes the other way around. You can see who stopped contributing. So let's say you're interested in someone who hasn't contributed in 6 months and you want to reach out to them, then you can do that as well. I don't know if anyone is using that feature. Well, I know some people are, but I'm curious if anyone here in this session is using something like this.
Georg, what was the question again? If they're using the feature to identify first-time contributors?
Yeah, a feature similar to what Grimoire Lab is offering, where you can see who contributed for the first time on the Git log, for example. It doesn't have to be this specific tool.
So I know Ray. I wish Ray was here because he would be able to explain this better than me, but we do track first time contributions and send people like a cool mug that says, has a GitLab logo and says hashtag my first MR merged for people when they have their first contribution merged to GitLab. I'm not sure the exact implementation of that. I don't know if that's through Paturgia or if we're using a label to identify those folks, but unfortunately, Ray would be the one to answer that question.
Okay, yeah, no worries. But it's cool that you do track that and reach out to the people. Just out of curiosity, if you want to send them mugs, I assume you need to somehow collect the physical address. How do you go about doing that?
Because yeah, it doesn't just... The email addresses are captured in the commits, and then there's like a form that is sent to them. Basically, we use a vendor so folks can, open a URL and kind of enter their information directly with this vendor who handles the, pick, pack, and ship kind of part of it.
That's awesome.
Related to that, I'll turn on my video since I'm talking. I put in the chat open hub, which is something that my community has been using to gather stats about like just contributors and who's contributing what. You can, if you wanted to look at ours, this is one that gives a contributor summary. And so we put our org in and you can see a list of everybody who the commits by top contributors. It's really interesting because it gives like a breakdown of percentage of code, like 30-day summary, 12-month summary, all time. And you can sort of see who's sort of dropped off, which I think is really fascinating, and which contributors have picked up steam. And that's helpful for us so that we understand who's, so I work in an open source community that is filled with universities. And so it allows us to then reach out to university leadership and say, okay, why aren't you contributing anymore? What happened? Is it just, you got a really big project going on and you can't contribute right now. or is something else going on? Are you going in a different direction entirely? So we found that pretty helpful.
Absolutely. And I really, really wish that the metrics conversation was a lot longer, but we'll try to figure out a way to continue the conversation, because it looks like there's a lot going on there. But I did also want to mention that it seems like someone in chat actually has the opposite problem. Like they have so many contributions and they're getting so overwhelmed that it's not so much a matter of measuring as it is acting on those measurements. And if you want to describe it a little bit more in depth, that'd be helpful. But I suppose the question might be, when you have a little bit of a fire hose of data and contributions coming in, how do you use metrics in order to narrow that down and manage it?
I'll take a stab at this one, but I don't think I have a great answer. I think, you know, there's probably two problems. One is like a high volume of contributions from the community, and you know, like the recent kind of Hacktoberfest uproar shows some of the issues there when you're like kind of receiving more contributions than you can keep up with, even if they're all the same type of thing, people opening issues and merge requests. It seems like there's also this other problem where you have lots of different kinds of things that you're kind of receiving from the community. So, and looking at the comment in the chat, it's, you know, about requests for mentorship and career support, helping people find jobs. It's like, there's a wide range of these types of requests coming in, and each one of them requires like a thoughtful response, calling on probably a different part of that person's expertise and experience, whoever that is that's responding to those. I think the problem is probably a little bit easier to solve when you're receiving a large volume of requests of a similar type. I think, you know, there's systems like, you know, service desk features, or, you know, like something like Zendesk, or, you know, that could probably help you with that if it's just a high volume of requests of the similar type. But when it's, you know, lots of different types of requests, I think that's a much more difficult problem to solve.
And I think one of the ways we've done this in the Kubernetes community is by creating programs around a lot of these efforts. So we have really strong programs around things like mentorship, for example. So, you know, when you can take the things that you get all the time, and rather than trying to handle those on a one-off basis, create programs around it so that you can do something that scales better for the size of your community. And I think it's also important to be clear about what you are going to help with and what you aren't going to help with. So a lot of us, you know, a lot of communities just say that we're not in the business of helping people find jobs. That's not what the community is about. So being clear about what bits of the requests you're willing to handle as a community and what bits you're not, and then take the bits that you're willing to handle. And if you've got a scale problem, figure out how you can put programs in place to scale them.
Yeah, I'll plus one Dawn on that one. I think having a really clear scope about, like, here's where this group of volunteers can help, here's stuff that we can't help with, and then also maybe even a path to, hey, but if you see, you know, if you find this kind of request super compelling, we do this to some extent in the WordPress community where I'm a community leader. Here's how to set up a program to do either peer support or to gather people together to be able to scope out a program and then support it going forward. So,
yeah, I hope that was a helpful answer. Kind of being a little bit selfish on my end, one of the main ways that I handle like a large influx is recognizing that it's not necessarily a problem of behavior or how many commits that you're getting or the influx of the actual content, but it's more a matter of social listening and recognizing that there are trends you can abstract from. And truth is in the trend, power is the pattern is one of the things that I tend to say. I got that from Chris Mercer. So the big question is, what's that trend and what is that big action that you can do in your project in order to make it easier for them to manage those comments on their own. So as we kind of come through, like, we have a ton of questions, and we just want to make sure that we're capable of getting to like a lot of larger questions. So I guess I'd like to toss it to everyone here. What is one of the biggest troubles or the biggest issues that you have implementing metrics in your communities?
We don't track people, and people don't want to be tracked. That's our biggest problem. And so, like, people want their privacy, and it's very difficult. And it's very difficult to identify what's a contribution to the project and what is a distraction from the project, because it's not always super clear. But more than anything, the stuff that makes it really hard for us to detect, like, who's taking part in a productive way. We didn't ask for permission to track people's activity way back in the day, because that was antithetical to a lot of our principles. And now getting that consent is super duper complicated. So I would love to hear from more communities that are like intensely privacy conscious about how you measure progress and impact, because yeah.
I can at least tell you that, again, I'm in Raleigh. I was involved in the local Jewish community here. And to say that these are people that do not wish, we used to have a directory, a printed directory of addresses of the community. And if you can imagine a group of people that do not want their address in a directory where people can find them, this would be the community because of the history. And over time, it was education. It was letting people know that we can't help them. We had a family services group, we had a vocational services group, we had a group where, you know, potentially help you find a job if you needed a job. And we couldn't help, we couldn't measure how we were doing, we couldn't see if we were expanding unless we knew you where you were. And there had to be a trust that we were gonna stop printing the directory, but we still have it. I can tell you that 10 years ago, that population was 10,000 households. It's now something in the neighborhood of 50,000 households. I won't say that we know where every single family is, maybe 75%. What I can tell you is that we didn't know until 3 years ago how large a community there was in Holly Springs or Fuquay Marina, which is 25 minutes south of Raleigh. And so we knew to put family services down there. We knew to put a social services office down there. And that became because of data feedback, but it was educating our population and it was making them feel comfortable that their data was safe. And one of the things, and it's still a problem today, is look at most nonprofit websites, there's no data policy. It's so simple. It's a page, it's a link off a front page saying, we're not gonna share your data, we're not selling your data. It's not on most nonprofit websites.
Yeah. And I think it might be worth kind of diving a little bit deeper into that. If you don't have that data privacy, what is the quickest and easiest way for you to implement that in your community without it being an incredibly overwhelming legal task?
I mean, my comment is always steal it from another nonprofit that did it already. But the realistic part is that every board has at least one attorney and one or two data people, and, you know, get an example and generate it. And most other people on a board won't argue, because if they've never thought about it, they don't know how to argue. And most of them will always listen to an intelligence attorney if you can find one. No offense to attorneys, of course.
So in the Chaos Project, what we have done, because we're all about measuring community health, is we have our own dashboard and we just link to it on our website and we say, hey, we have all this information, go check it out yourself. You can see what data we have. And it's a service that we provide to our own community, being fully transparent. But then if we need it for our own you know, we want to understand how the community is doing, then we have that data readily available there. And we announced it on the mailing list. We let everyone know, hey, this is happening. And if someone wants to opt out, they can opt out and we anonymize them.
Awesome contributions. And unfortunately, we are coming a little bit to the end here. So there's one big thing that I kind of want to make sure exists in the metrics conversation, because it's huge, right? And all your communities are going to be very, very different. So what was one big key insight that you got from this conversation? What are you going to be taking home with you, so to speak? And everyone feel free to contribute what you think, either in chat, mic, or over video.
So one thing John said earlier is he wanted to understand whether the issues that were being closed are meaningful to the community, and by using the thumbs up feature. So I already created a pull request to the chaos community to add that to our closed issues metric.
Any other big insights, or perhaps you're also coming away with a more defined problem? What is that one big thing you think you need to solve in your community?
Yeah, I'll just add, I appreciated Dawn's perspective on creating like working groups or committees to kind of focus on specific areas where you're seeing high volumes of requests, and also Andrew's point to having a clear scope for what your community kind of can and cannot support. And Georg, thanks for opening that pull request. That was awesome.
I thought the comment around measuring impact and helping contributors have or community members better understand the impact of their work was really, really insightful. And I think that's a great way to navigate away from vanity metrics and more to measurements that will empower people for years to come. So that was a good reminder.
Thank you so much. And we do have 2 minutes plus some time afterward if you just kind of want to talk more interpersonally and whatnot. We do have a little bit of time for any final thoughts, not necessarily related to a specific question or anything along those lines.
I just want to thank you for having this sort of breakout. This is a good break to a very technical day, and getting to do something where I can take it back to the groups I volunteer with is a really cool thing. I hope a lot of people in here connect and put their information in that Google Doc you set up.
The one thing I'd maybe just like to add is that, you know, what you measure reinforces the behaviors that drive it. So just think really carefully about what you measure and how you do it, because it will drive behavior. And if people can game it to be on the leaderboard, they will.
Yeah, that is huge. That is huge. Oftentimes what you measure also means what you value. And if people know what you value in that community, they will change their behaviors. So sometimes it could end up changing the very culture of the community when you say you are changing the metric toward a specific goal. I really like that contribution. It looks like Amber is wanting to say something. So before we do that, just closing statements. Metrics are hard and they're difficult and they're very open. And we're talking about something that is highly socio-ecological. we're measuring communities, and getting a grasp on that can be a little bit difficult. So we'd absolutely love to continue the conversation. We have these conversations every day in the chaos community. And I am also more than happy and willing to network. If all of you want to network as well, if you have questions you weren't wanting to bring up or anything like that, please feel free to connect with each other on LinkedIn or anything like that. We're going to make sure that this conversation does continue over on the Google Doc, where we have networking options, an entire list of resources. And one of my biggest goals coming out of this conversation was for us to give you what is essentially like the beginnings of a toolbox that allow you to kind of refer to it throughout the course of your conversation on that Google Doc. So thank you so much. It was a lot of great engagement. And I think it was a really good conversation as well.